Well, good morning, everybody. And let me first begin by thanking Chairman Powell for his leadership over the past 7 months. Mr. Chairman, you have passionately embraced your responsibility to expand the reach of the University of Texas system to more people in Texas. And you have addressed head-on the changing environment of higher education. You have worked tirelessly to better serve the over 200,000 students that we educate on a daily basis who have been entrusted to us for their education. Your commitment is admirable and my greatest appreciation to you. I also want to express my deep gratitude to the members of the Board of Regents and the members of our two special advisory task forces, particularly Task Force Chairs Regent Pavich and Regent Hall, and Vice Chairman Hicks, Regent Gary, Regent Stilwell, and Regent Cranberg, who have also served on these task forces, in addition to many of our presidents and provosts. Thank you for your diligence and your dedication and your openness to various points of view in the spirit of continuous improvement and innovation. And I salute our friends, our members of the Commission 125, our alumni, our faculty, our staff, and our students for providing important feedback to me and to the Board of Regents over the past few months. I have never seen more engagement in such a positive way from so many constituents. Many who are with us today, Melinda, it is great to see you. In their generous efforts to enhance excellence across the University of Texas system, as a system of 15 wonderful campuses, we will be better positioned to educate our students and create knowledge that benefits society because you have shared your ideas and your recommendations. This has given me a profound sense of pride in serving as your chancellor and for the democratic principles which make our nation vibrant and make her great. As I have said many times, I became a doctor because I believe in saving lives. I firmly believe that education saves lives as well, and that education is a transformational experience, not only for the student who's on our campus, but for generations to follow. All of us engaged in this discussion are involved in higher education because our own personal experiences were formative and fulfilling, and we want the young people of Texas to have even better opportunities. Very simply, it is our duty. That is our duty to make sure that the next generation has greater opportunities than we have, and the best way of achieving that and assuring that is through the power of education. In Texas and across the nation, universities, no doubt, are facing major challenges. In the global arena, we're encountering serious competition from other nations, which in some cases are now offering comparable higher education opportunities and cutting-edge research. And at home, we're facing a demand for more accessible, accountable, and affordable education in a world where terabytes of information could be transferred instantly to all corners of the world. And students are at great ease within these portals of communication that challenge at times traditional classrooms and even how we teach our courses. Add to this the economic downturn and the reductions in federal and state funding around the country. Add, you know, the loss of market value in some of our endowments because of these economic challenges we're facing. There is no doubt that we face a situation more challenging than anything that we have ever seen in our time. Our traditional revenue streams will not sustain our current models of educating undergraduate and professional students, and so we must change how we teach future generations of students and how we operate our academic and our health institutions. Well, today, Texas finds itself at the epicenter of a national debate on the future of higher education. But I also firmly believe that no university system is better poised than the University of Texas system to lead the debate and to offer solutions. As Texans, it is our culture to lead, and we will become the national model for reinventing public higher education in America. The UT system has a remarkable responsibility. We award over one-third of all undergraduate degrees and three-fourths of all health professional degrees in this great state of Texas. UT institutions bring in almost three-quarters of all research funds awarded to public universities in Texas. Texas is very strong in its research engine. In fact, we are in the top three states in the United States of America here in Texas. We are a large and we are a globally respected system of higher education that reflects the scope and the ambition of our state. We are strong. We are a great University of Texas system, but we must live in a culture of continual improvement. And thus, my friends, the work is never done. You know, the minute that we stop that philosophy of continual improvement, we will fall behind, and that is just not the Texas spirit. At the May meeting of the board, I presented an initiative called a framework for advancing excellence throughout the University of Texas system. I'm very grateful to the regents for adopting this initiative unanimously. The framework includes a comprehensive dashboard that will guide the UT system in making management and policy decisions and will bring the system's accountability and transparency to the highest level. And with new action items and metrics for advancing excellence, we will place a more concentrated emphasis on productivity. It will also help us to plan for the future. We intend to move our framework ahead of the curve of American public higher education as supported by the Task Forces on Productivity and Excellence. Their work, together with all our presidents and our system administration and faculty and staff, will ensure that we improve our effectiveness, allowing us to bend the rising cost curve of higher education in order to better serve our students. My office, in consultation with our presidents and incorporating the best ideas of our two regions' task forces, has developed this action plan since May. It has been a very busy time. We've also benefited from the visionary leaders who have preceded us and who have made accountability, efficiency, and transparency a vital part of the system's work over the past decade. Under the leadership of former boards of regents, former chancellors, and the University of Texas System Administration, we began issuing annual accountability and performance reports in 2004 and launched a number of initiatives that support this work. Our accountability reports, in fact, are considered national models. But what is different then about the new framework action plan? Well, for one, it is far more comprehensive, it has far greater scale, and it puts greater emphasis on productivity and outcomes. We have taken the broad issues I introduced in May and created action items that will provide solutions to the challenges and the opportunities before us. And when looking at these action items, it is important to recognize from the outset, and this is very important, that one size does not fit all. To give you an idea of how the framework is organized, I will describe the nine focal areas and highlight some of the proposed action items associated with each one. Bear in mind that the framework is not intended to be prescriptive, but we will hold our institutions accountable for the goals outlined in the action plan. That's also a very important point because the innovation, the creativity of how to address these issues in campuses where one size doesn't fit all is so dependent upon the creative leadership of our presidents, their teams, and their faculty and their staff. I cannot emphasize enough how critically important it is that all of the efforts within this framework also be critically aligned between our institutions, our UT system administration, and the Board of Regents. So I believe the action plan charts a clear path towards that alignment. There are nine focal areas in this plan. The first, of course, is about our students, improving undergraduate student access and success. We also want to make the University of Texas system a wonderful environment to recruit and to retain great faculty, great staff, great administrators. We want the power of the system to augment our strength and our creativity in research. We have a responsibility to contain our costs to the greatest degree possible, and therefore there is an emphasis on productivity and efficiency. Cyber infrastructure of our campuses over the next decade are going to be exceedingly important, and thus another important emphasis point. Philanthropy. I'm firmly convinced that we cannot transform ourselves from good to great without the great philanthropic support of our alumni and our supporters. There'll be an emphasis point on PhD and doctoral degree programs. Six of our campuses are health institutions, and we have a responsibility to also enhance the health of this great state and our nation. And also, there's a tremendous opportunity to expand the educational and the health opportunities in South Texas and the Lower Rio Grande Valley. So let me first talk about the first focus area, which is undergraduate student access and success. We're going to be emphasizing 3 points: increasing the total numbers of degrees conferred, reducing the financial impact on students and families, and increase and enhance blended and online, in addition to our traditional learning approaches to augment student success. Again, the focus is on our students. Well, under increasing the total number of degrees conferred, we want to strengthen our, I want to ask our campuses to strengthen methods to increase number of degrees conferred. Well, I remember when I was, one of the most important decisions I believe a university makes is when they send that letter of acceptance to an applicant. How many of you remember the day you went out to that mailbox and got your letter of acceptance? Right? For me, it was almost 33 years ago, and I can remember it like it was yesterday. But I also remember feeling a great sense of responsibility that my life was going to change, that I was going to have to really stay focused, and that my family, my parents, were going to sacrifice. Well, I would submit to you that that responsibility is also encumbered by the university. Once we offer that letter of acceptance, we have a responsibility to make certain that that student is college ready. We have a responsibility to make certain that we provide outstanding advising. And we have a responsibility to make sure that we're there at the right time for tutoring or mentoring such that we can optimize the most wonderful outcome, which is conferring a high quality degree. I firmly believe that when a student fails for academic reasons, we too have also failed. And so again, a very important emphasis point. We want to review and strengthen enrollment management plans that consider the demographic changes of the state of Texas. I think I've got one of the best jobs in the world. I have an opportunity to visit 15 great gems, great state, which are our campuses. And one thing I have certainly found out is that our campuses are very unique. They educate a different demography, a different region. And that's the beautiful aspect about the system. So when we're talking about increasing enrollment management plans, when I either go to UT Brownsville or UT Permian Basin or UT Tyler, their strategy is very much focused on increasing enrollment for both students in the classroom. But another very important strategy for them is also to reach out to those students in rural Texas, either through online learning or even, when appropriate, online degrees. Now, that strategy is going to be very different for University of Texas at Austin. I can see, again, I can't speak for UT Austin, but I could see a strategy for that would be how can we improve and compress the time to graduation? How can we better utilize our space such that an important outcome of that would be, because of that,
we can actually matriculate more freshmen without actually altering, you know, the very optimal student-faculty ratios that they've been working on. So again, one size doesn't fit all. Well, each institution is also going to be asked to revise and enhance action plans to become top performers in four-year graduation rates for full-time students among their respective peer groups. Again, one size doesn't fit all. But for the University of Texas at Austin, that four-year graduation rate is will be about 70%, if not exceeding 70%, when you compare where UT Austin should be. If we want UT Austin to be at the very top, that is what we would like to see. And I'm so proud that Bill Powers has already put together a task force just this past month, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what the recommendations of that task force are going to be and then how that gets implemented. But I'm also looking forward to see the plans of our other presidents. But I also understand when I speak to Diana Natalicio, you know, a student body, when you're taking a look at graduation rates, you also have to really understand what the student body is like. I certainly understand that, for example, at UT Arlington or UTEP and other of our campuses, we have many students transferring from our community colleges. But because we can deaggregate and see improvement on all fronts, we should be also able to see, with this mindset, improvements in our graduation rates or time to degrees for our transfer students. Other relevant cohorts, when I see it at Cigarroa, a large percentage of your class are coordinated admission programs for students who will ultimately end up at UT Austin. But if a student actually gets that wonderful first year at UTSA, and I also know that once you go to UTSA, you may not want to leave UTSA. A large percentage of those students are staying at UTSA because they love it. But if they transfer to UT Austin, I would also like those students to have a seamless transfer and also graduate in 4 years if they're full-time students. But I'm also very sensitive that in many cases we have part-time students. So again, this is not prescriptive, but it's setting expectations. We want to implement tuition policies that incentivize students to graduate in 4 years. Again, we want to inculcate this culture. UT Austin has flat rate tuition. UT Dallas, UTEP has four-year fixed tuitions. I understand that that may not be possible in some campuses, again, because of the student demography, the student profile. But it doesn't mean that the leadership of that campus cannot come up with strategies that may be more creative that incentivizes shortening times to degree. We also want to implement innovative plans to improve student advising to enhance persistent rates towards shortening time to degree. This is a very exciting subject that was covered in our task force on blended and online learning. Later today, you will hear about a partnership that we're going to establish, but there is some incredibly exciting interactive software that really provides better advising to our students. So for example, if you're at a community college and you want to pursue a biology degree at University of Texas at Arlington, it will tell you which courses will transfer and which courses count towards your degree. So students will have better planning ability. If you're a freshman and you want to graduate in business and you decide, well, you know, maybe I'll take all my tough courses at the end of 4 years, in my last senior year. But before you know it, you're overwhelmed. And so this advising ability will also tell you, you know, if you do this, I think you're going to have a tough time finishing up your fourth year. And again, if we can improve student advising, that's also a critically important part of improving time to degree. We have that responsibility. And believe me, I was so excited about this new interactive software that, and Chairman, we've spoken to students and their eyes sparkle, you know, when we talk about this. The second emphasis point under student access and success is reducing financial impact on students and families. I think it is incumbent upon us to be as transparent as possible, to develop annual full cost disclosure statements for students and families to encourage graduating 4 years or less or shorter, or graduation rates also, but also understanding that when a student especially full-time students, decide to graduate in 5 years or 6 years, what does that actually mean in regards to costs? I think every student and every family needs to understand what consequences each decision makes. And I think we can be much more transparent than this. And we also want to identify and further implement strategies to reduce debt burden for students. Again, tuition policies, you know, can certainly affect this, but one can also make philanthropy a greater focus on scholarships. And again, you know, one of the emphasis points of this framework will be how can we augment philanthropy for our 15 campuses, which I will focus on a little bit later. Well, again, one of the most exciting parts of the past 9 months is really to hear incredible speakers and incredible interactions from our presidents and our students on what the potential is for blended and online learning. There was excitement in that task force, and there was unanimous agreement on what recommendations can be put forth before this board on how University of Texas system can leapfrog in this very important strategy of enhancing student success. There were three recommendations, and Chairman Hall will be a little bit more specific later on today. But in large part, the board will allocate funds to establish a Regental merit-based grant program to become national leaders in augmenting student success through blended and online courses. We will enhance the use of technology to improve student learning, especially in large gateway courses. How many of you do you remember being at a 300, 400 class size introductory biology course where, you know, it was a little daunting and you couldn't interact with your professor very well? Well, there is some incredible interactive software that can actually bring the student closer to that professor and improve student learning outcomes, success, and even reduce the cost of a four-year education to a student. And we will hire a national expert on blended and online learning, again, to facilitate success for our 15 campuses. I don't want to build a large infrastructure here at UT system, but we do need someone who can help us be the best stewards of the money that the board will allocate today, and to be able to facilitate success for our campuses in something that's extremely important for the next generation of students that we're responsible for. The second area of the framework focus is on making sure that the UT system provides a very exciting environment to recruit and retain outstanding faculty, staff, and administrators. And the emphasis points here are, again, the recruitment and the retention and rewarding great faculty, utilizing compensation strategies that incentivize greater performance and excellence, strengthening our annual performance evaluations, strengthening post-tenure review, conducting external evaluations of our colleges and schools, and again, recruiting outstanding administrative and faculty leadership. To be more specific, in regards to rewarding great faculty and also in helping us recruit and retain great faculty, one of the greatest decisions that this Board of Regents has made is the allocation of STARS funding for our campuses. The STARS funding has been traditionally meant to recruit outstanding faculty from around the world who are on the verge of becoming members of the National Academy of Science. But in these discussions in our task forces, it was asked, well, is it possible to add a little extra flexibility to the STARS funding such that our campuses can also recruit nationally and globally recognized teachers? I said, of course. And here's an example. So let's say there is a great astronomy professor in the East Coast, and that professor ended up marrying somebody from Edinburgh, Texas. And that spouse had said, you know, honey, I've been here for 15 years, and I've been very patient, but it's time to go back to Texas. Robert Nelson finds out about this interest because the mother of the spouse lives in Edinburgh. And so Robert calls this person up, this great astronomer, and says, well, listen, we'd like to recruit you here to UT Pan Am. He goes, well, you know, I've got some inklings to go down, but the reason why my course is so successful is because I've got this really interactive software for, you know, this course that I teach. I need the planetarium. And Robert Nelson goes, we can take care of that. We have STARS funding for this. I'll also submit to you, we're not going to lower our standards about what we mean by national and international recognition. But the fact is that we have opportunities to utilize this incredible resource for recruiting members on the verge or members of the national academies, but also nationally recognized teachers. And we will expand the Teaching Excellence Awards given by the regents. Last night, we had a spectacular dinner celebrating the recipients of the Regents Teaching Excellence Awards. But one thing, you know, Ken Stein is not shy. He's just not. And I don't think I've misstated their chairman. But Ken goes, you know, I love my colleagues on the academic campuses. But don't you think we ought to provide some Regents Teaching Excellence Awards to our great faculty at the Health Science Centers? I said, absolutely. And so because of all this, I think, Chairman, I'll get this board to vote for that. But again, we want to, again, reward great teachers across our 15 campuses. Well, I'll ask our campuses again. I don't know what the right answer is for this, but let's ask our campuses to develop more creative strategies of developing compensation for faculty administrators to better reward and incentivize performance in our goal of continual improvement. But if we do that, we also have to strengthen annual performance evaluations for chancellors, for executive vice chancellors for business affairs, but really for every employee across the University of Texas system, because it's also a useful tool for development. We will also strengthen post-tenure reviews. Kind of a story. There's 15 presidents here, and I would say we're all a little competitive. And I remember the first year I became president of the Health Science Center, and I submitted to the docket kind of the review of our faculty at the Health Science Center after their post-tenure reviews. And I got a little defensive because, you know, I knew that my faculty were doing outstanding work, and yet they were being rated and conveyed to our regents as satisfactory. And I looked a little, I did a little homework, and that's kind of the way we do it. And I felt that that doesn't fairly represent the great work that our faculty are doing. I mean, if you're hitting it out of the park every day, I think you're exceeding expectations. And so again, we have ways of strengthening our post-tenure reviews that more fairly and better differentiate performance, but they also have to be used to foster faculty development. Now, in my past, at being at a variety of universities and being at a health science centers, you know, external reviews were very important. And this board, about 6 years ago, developed a policy for reviewing organized research units every 5 or 6 years. But I submit to you that the most important unit in a university are our colleges. And, you know, accreditation reviews are very important, but they're usually just focused on the educational aspect. But I think if we have some external reviews to take a look at our colleges in a more holistic way that provide valuable information to our presidents and to the chancellor and to the regents, again, it's having some external eyes saying, you know, you guys are doing a great job, or there's areas of improvement, or why is your development not achieving its goals? And I found that to be exceedingly useful at Harvard, at Hopkins. John, in the NCI designated cancer centers, you get a rigorous review externally, and they are very constructive, but they are also tough. And I found that out, you know, when the NCI designated cancer in San Antonio was being reviewed. They're not easy. We also want to strengthen our strategies that assure a rigorous selection and appointment process to recruit outstanding department chairs. One of the things that came out in the task force is that, you know, in some cases, the role and scope of responsibilities of department chairs are not clearly delineated. And in fact, the appointment for a department chair can sometimes be a short three-year appointment, which is pretty tough to really understand what the department's doing, tough to take advantage of opportunities, tough to make tough choices, again, in your focus of advancing excellence. And I think there is an opportunity here to really strengthen, you know, how we select our department chairs or other leadership. And as Senator Zaffirini has always stated, and always remember casting a wide net to make sure that we're also being sensitive to diversity of our leadership. In research, boy, what potential the University of Texas system has with 9 outstanding academic campuses and 6 health science centers. We will have 3 emphasis points here: promoting strategic research collaborations, augmenting technology transfer, commercialization, Regent Dannenbaum, and supporting our emerging research universities. So there is an incredible amount of synergy that can happen among our campuses in regards to collaboration, but also between academic and health institutions, but also with other entities within the state and within our nation. You know, we heard yesterday this board affirm a new Ph.D. degree program on clinical translational science. And that is utilizing the power of system by bringing 3 campuses together to be able to award a degree. So bringing the best of UTSA, of UT Austin and the Health Science Center San Antonio, in working together to develop a joint degree. And Senator, I know that's been very important to you. We want to identify new revenue streams, including philanthropy, to support research missions. All of us who are engaged in science, you know, at the highest levels, understand that our NIH budget and other revenue streams are flattening, if not declining. And so it's so important for us to be able to convey our message and our successes better, and we need to foster greater philanthropy across the state and our nation. We have a shared responsibility. We can't put the full burden on the state. We can't put the full burden on the student. We can't put the full burden on the university. Our community and our regions and our supporters need to also do their part. We want to augment technology transfer and commercialization. I'm extremely proud of this board for making a standing committee on tech transfer commercialization. It's in its infancy right now, but it's already morphing in a beautiful way. Yesterday we heard a great discussion on, you know, how can we bring industry leaders more into the academic environment to better advise us? How can we actually develop a fund that can incentivize bringing, you know, the incredible discoveries that our faculty make to the benefit of society by bringing it to the market? And so this board today will recommend a Horizon Fund for that, not only to address proof of concept, but also address proof of relevance and also to protect our equity interests. And so I think there's great potential over here as well. And then, of course, you know, we want to support our emerging research universities. And we will be asking each of these campuses to develop business plans to operationalize the strategic plan required by House Bill 51. But I will also say that House Bill 51 also incentivizes excellence in research and centers of excellence across all our campuses. So that bill is actually focused beyond just our emerging research universities. The fourth focus will be on implementing additional cost containment strategies. Again, 4 emphasis points here: standardized system-wide operational systems, implement additional shared service initiatives, conduct administrative organizational reviews, and review and implement effective space utilization. So under system-wide operational systems, I will ask Executive Vice Chancellor Scott Kelly to work with the business officers across the system to prioritize a list of system-wide operational systems to be standardized, and then create a longer-term strategy for standardizing those systems. Over the past 2 years, many of our campuses have gone on PeopleSoft and a common HR financial system. So it's not beyond our reach that, in fact, you know, we can actually develop a common payroll or other common backdoor office initiatives that can save millions of dollars for our campuses. Again, I don't have all the answers right now, but isn't this worth focusing on? We want to also continue to define and implement shared service initiatives to system administration for the benefit of our campuses. Again, what can we do to save a dollar on the campus? About 5 years ago, I remember being at a system council meeting for the health institutions. And Dr. Schein was talking about shared services and about how, you know, what is the potential of actually utilizing the purchasing power of UT system to get the best pricing on reagents and other scientific equipment for our laboratories. Well, I remember we were all a little uncomfortable about that, and gee, that's, I don't know, that's going to be hard. And what do you mean, we're going to give that to MD Anderson? And I don't know. Well, you know, Ken got out his hammer. You know, you will move forward in this direction. Well, you know, we've saved millions of dollars. And, you know, over the next 5 years, we're going to have to be purchasing a tremendous amount of funds for imaging equipment. Just imagine we can utilize the purchasing power of system to save, you know, to again, contain costs. Again, this is not compromising on quality. It's just doing things in a smarter, better way such that we can adapt to these challenging economic environments. And I think there's great potential here for our academic campuses. That's the power of a system. Well, if it's good for the goose, it's good for the gander. If we're going to be reviewing our colleges on a periodic basis, I think it's important to also externally review our administrative structures on a periodic basis. I did this 2 years ago at UT System, and it was a very powerful tool for me to be able to better streamline UT System administration. And so again, periodic external reviews will be important to help us be as efficient and as effective as possible. We also want to review and implement effective space utilization. We need to develop criteria to better assess and improve academic, research, and administrative space, including productivity indices, and review our space utilization policies. I don't think we could be building new buildings unless we're currently utilizing our space effectively, or unless, you know, a building is completely outdated and unsafe. I'll use an example. This kind of hit me right head on about a year and a half ago when I was at a meeting between trustees and presidents. And one trustee stated, you know, I'm very interested in increasing enrollment in my university. And a hand came up very quickly and said, well, if we do that, we need more classrooms. And the trustee basically asked, well, prove it to me, because if you can, we have to modify our business plans, but we'll do so. Well, 3 months later, the president comes in and goes, we can manage without more academic space if we utilize our classrooms, you know, more effectively. So again, it's important for us to really look within. Information technology and the cyber infrastructure of our campuses is going to be exceedingly important over the next decade. This Board of Regents, this past decade, really basically embarked upon the Competitiveness Initiative, which is a major allocation of funds towards academic and research space to enhance our STEM fields. But I will submit to you that over the next decade, what's going to be more important than bricks and mortar will be, do we have the adequate computing resources to achieve our mission in education and to do state-of-the-art research to make sure that we do not fall behind. When I visit our campuses, and I think my visit at MD Anderson, John, about a year and a half ago, you told me that, you know, in order to reach the full potential of developing targeted therapies, we need to have the computational power to better understand the millions and millions of data out there such that we can better simulate drugs and better determine which drugs will impact to the greatest degree a patient. We can't do this without computational power, and we'll be in trouble if we don't stay ahead of this. And later on today, Chairman, part of the framework is to do an RFP to help us determine what is the best strategy for the next 5 years, and we will need some funds for that. So I hope that you can affirm that in your motion. So I've already spoken about this. We also have to prioritize a dashboard. This is, again, out of the Productivity and Excellence Dashboard, or out of our task force. We determined that the University of Texas system needs to develop a dashboard that can really provide us very interactive data that's both consistent and reliable to help us determine, are we meeting our goals? What are the trends across the important outputs that we want to make? And then, even more important than that, is how can we use this data to prognosticate about how to make better decisions into the future to address the changing environments that we're faced with? So it's important to have data, but we also have to use this as a diagnostic tool to better predict our future. And so, again, out of the Productivity and Excellence Task Force and bringing together our presidents, we came up with what a dashboard might look like, although it'll be far more comprehensive than this. But it'll determine what we're going to be following as a system, not only what we're doing this current year, but over time, such that you can also assess progress over time or lack of progress. We'll take a look at the institutions at a more in-depth level, and then also at our colleges at a more in-depth level. So anybody could get into this interactive dashboard, and it'll help our regents, it'll help our presidents, it'll help system make better decisions. Now, I will also submit to you that this is an evolving dashboard, and we've been through a very rigorous time period of a lot of requests for data. And I think we're getting to a new steady state. But I'll also say, you know, there are going to be more requests when appropriate to be able to make sure that this dashboard ends up becoming a national model, but for the use of making better decisions. And I think that's very important for a system the size of the University of Texas system. Well, again, if you speak to Ron DeSafity, or if you speak to any president, we understand we can't get from good to great without philanthropic support. And when you take a look at the University of Texas system, 70% of all our philanthropy comes from three campuses: UT Austin, MD Anderson, Southwestern. That's not to say that our other campuses aren't doing well, but it is to say that we have an opportunity to get better. And so one of the emphasis points in this framework is to develop and implement a multi-year business plan demonstrating a balanced and effective development program with appropriate targets and goals tied to institutional strategic plans. It is vital that we do better in philanthropy and that it makes up a more consistent revenue stream, a more predictable revenue stream, such that we can lower the cost per degree for our students and we can achieve greater success in our research missions. I'm very excited that the board is interested in renewing the Strength in Numbers initiative to make strategic investments in key development personnel and operations to increase private revenue, including support to system to assist and provide to individual institutions high-quality professional development officers where needed. You know, my development office at Health Science Center San Antonio when I got there was broken. Well, it wasn't broken, but we weren't achieving the goals that we wanted. I came from Harvard, I came from Yale, and the development officer, Dr. DePino, said, we need to start a capital campaign. I go, well, what's a reasonable capital campaign? Well, let's go forth for $300 million. I said, well, that should be easy. You know, billion-dollar campaigns at Harvard and Hopkins, a piece of cake. Every time I'd come up to system administration, Ken Stein would tell me, how are you doing on your capital campaign? I go, not so well. He goes, well, the chancellor's a little concerned about that. I'll never forget that elevator ride to the chancellor's office. Well, I realized then that I needed some help. I called Ron DeSafity, and she gave me some advice. We implemented that advice, and we completed that goal. Well, as much accountability as we want to provide in our undergraduate students, we have a responsibility to have the same accountability on our PhD and doctorate degree programs. They deserve it. So we want to assure high-performance programs. We want to mentor and advise our doctorate students better, and we want to incentivize the shortened time to complete PhDs. I mean, nationally, only about 45% of PhD students are finishing their graduate studies in 6 years. I think we can do better than that. So we want to strengthen the criteria for review and continuation of our doctoral degree programs, remediate them when necessary, or realign them when necessary. But again, that's the president's decision. We want to strengthen and develop innovative plans to improve PhD student advising to shorten time to degree. Again, advising is such an important tool. to be able to provide better expectations between our students, our graduate students, and their mentors. So we want to set clear criteria and expectations in agreements between the student and the department regarding time to completion, including incentives and deadlines and consequences for failing to meet expectations. Again, I think when individuals and students understand what the expectations are, they always reach that benchmark. And again, so I'll be placing greater emphasis on this. And I think if we do better at this, we're going to be able to recruit graduate students, the best graduate students from around the world. Well, I can't help it. I'm still a physician, and I really care about the health of Texas. And so we're going to have four emphasis points. Again, implement transformation in medical education, advance medical education and research in Austin, advance Austin and other metropolitan areas as technology, biotechnology research hubs, and improve patient safety and quality. So over the past 3 months, you've seen a lot of wonderful articles written about innovations in medical education. And this idea came about as a result of a retreat where Dan Podolsky stated, you know, it's been about 100 years since we've really changed how we're educating students. Isn't it a time that UT kind of shakes these pillars a little bit and let's see what we can do? And in fact, there have been a lot of positive articles about this. And now we're going to really want to bring in some external eyes to make sure that we're making progress. Under the existing affiliation agreement, under B, where we want to advance medical education research in Austin, under the existing affiliation agreement that we currently have, it enhances linkages between the Seton Healthcare family, UT Southwestern Medical Center, UT System, UT Austin, and other key supporters to expand medical education and research in Austin, including increased biomedical research programs and number of faculty in Austin. Another very important emphasis point here is to further develop and continue working towards the comprehensive UT strategic plan for four-year research intensive medical education, including expanded residencies, biomedical research, and interdisciplinary health education in Austin. I believe these two emphasis points will be a great catalyst in allowing UT Austin to reach its full potential. We want to advance Austin and other metropolitan areas as technology, biotechnology hubs. And so we want to use and leverage our research productivity and the reputation of UT System and UT Austin to attract greater resources for the advancement of UT and Austin as a technology, biotechnology hub. There is phenomenal talent here, incredible talent represented by so many faculty at the University of Texas in Austin. If we can better leverage this, and use the Horizon Fund, Regent Tannenbaum, and utilize our key industry leaders, there is no doubt Central Texas can become a huge hub consistent with our governor's vision. But we have equally powerful institutions in other metropolitan areas, such as Dallas-Fort Worth, Arlington, El Paso. Again, utilizing the strength of the UT system, we can do better. And, of course, we need to improve patient safety and quality. We've spoken a lot about declining revenue streams, but I submit to you that our health institutions, in addition to declining state revenues and federal revenues that we've had to address, reimbursements for how we're caring for patients right now is going to decline over the next 15 or 20 years. So we need to be adapting now for that. But we also need to do so where we never compromise on patient safety and clinical outcomes. At the end of the day, it's about providing outstanding care to our patients, and we have to do it more innovative because we're going to have less resources. Well, I'm from South Texas, and again, this has been very important to me. We have over 33% of our student body is south of San Antonio. So what a remarkable opportunity for us to have a greater impact. If I remember correctly, it was Regent Stilwell who said, we need to plant a taller flag in South Texas. And so there are two emphasis points here, which is to finalize and advance a comprehensive South Texas Lower Diagonal Valley Plan and Juliet, where is Juliet, to establish UT Brownsville as a freestanding four-year university. So Over the past year and a half, David Pryor and Ken Sein and all the presidents have been focusing on developing a plan that includes enhancing STEM fields success, expanding UTEACH, the great UTEACH at Austin program, expand that into the Valley such that we have a greater impact, Mayor Boswell, on our K through 12 students, educating a better cohort of teachers. We want to establish an outstanding clinical simulation center at the Regional Academic Health Center that can improve our health professional education in South Texas. We want to expand our residencies throughout South Texas, including Laredo Center Zaffanini, and we want to enhance biomedical research. And we also want to further develop and continue working towards plans for interdisciplinary health education, including comprehensive four-year medical education. But I submit to you, Mayor, we can't do this without the five core residency programs, and we can't do this without the tremendous support of philanthropy. We also want to enhance our linkages between UT Brownsville and UT Pan Am, the Regional Academic Health Center, our Laredo Regional Campus, our communities, and our public schools. There is great potential here, and in fact, so much potential that we have fostered the interest of very large national foundations that will now are coming in October to have a significant summit on how we can enhance South Texas in a very positive way that not only transforms the region but can be a model for other regions in the state, in the United States. And we're going to identify to Robert Nelson and to Juliet resources to expand the STARS programs for our campuses at UT Pan Am and UT Brownsville, since you have not received that because y'all are recipients of HEAF funding. And so we didn't have an avenue to do that, but I figured it out. And in that light, we want to establish UT Brownsville as a comprehensive four-year university, ensuring full educational opportunities for the region. So those are the nine focus areas that we're going to be focusing on. So in closing, I would like to make one final point. We want the world to know that the University of Texas system has produced a comprehensive plan that raises accountability and productivity to new levels of excellence, while at the same time supporting our faculty and administrators to their fullest extent. We do have a great system of higher education in Texas. My father went to the University of Texas in Austin, and he became an incredible lifelong learner. And through that passion and through his love of the university, he transferred that to his 10 children who also pursued a higher education degree. So the message there is that it not only affects a student, it affects generations. And all his grandchildren now are receiving a higher education degree because of that experience. The UT system is represented by its 15 institutions is strong. This action plan will set new goals and standards for our institutions. And I do believe that we must continually ask ourselves how we can improve and adapt to this rapidly changing world. I want to publicly thank, from the bottom of my heart, the 15 presidents of our campuses for their outstanding leadership. And I thank the 19,000 faculty members who teach, who do great research, and serve at the system universities and our health science centers. And as chancellor, as a fellow faculty member, and as a father of a UT student, I want our presidents and I want our faculty and staff to know that I deeply value what you do every day for your institutions, for the students of Texas, and for this world. I ask you to continue holding yourselves to the highest standards for your profession and to seek excellence in everything that you do. And I ask the entire University of Texas family, including our alumni and including our supporters, to join me and the Board of Regents in renewing our compact with the people of Texas to produce a world-class educational experience for our students that responds to the challenges that we're facing today. I am absolutely convinced that by working together, we will become a national model that will make higher education more responsive and responsible to the people we serve. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. And to our students, we must not forget our students. I thank you for your trust, your hard work, and your confidence in the University of Texas. It is a privilege, a profound privilege, and honored to be a part of your education. So thank you very much for your attention. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my remarks. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Well, before we do that, I'd like to give you a round of applause.